Oh boy, we're talking about Mugen Train, baby! Only what, like 2 months after it came out? Yeah, nice going, Danny. Real timely video you got going here. Look, it got made, didn't it? Alright, get off my back! And thank God it did, because this movie's insane. Mugen Train improves on nearly every aspect of the Demon Slayer anime in such significant ways. And don't get me wrong, the anime is awesome. Clever, exciting action, great, memorable characters, but the story's nothing I'd call, you know, deep. Well, welcome to the goddamn abyss. Mugen Train, alright, they went too deep. They said, get your snorkels on, kids, and prepare to cry, because we're gonna hurt you. This movie is so goddamn sad. Oh, no! No! Oh, stop it. Oh, stop. Oh, stop. Oh, no, stop it! Oh, stop. The movie's a nightmare. Pun absolutely intended. It's a good nightmare. Still, also, hi, welcome to Face Cam, by the way. Can you tell why I've held off on using it until now? In a bit of a transitional period, living-wise. But what makes it so sad? Because honestly, the first season wasn't nearly this emotional. What makes this movie such a vast improvement on the Demon Slayer anime? And honestly, one of the best animated movies I've ever seen. I'm sure you've already seen dozens of reviews on this movie, and anyone who wants to see it has already seen it 3 months ago. That's why instead of a review, I'm gonna do more of a breakdown. What makes this movie so good? Is it the demons? Is it the slayers? Is it the thick, mugenous train? We're gonna find out, so grab your boarding tickets and get and board the train, because I'm gonna punch up. This is Mugen Train. The film picks up immediately after the ending of the first season. All the classics are here. You got your Tanjiros, your Nezukos, your pig boys. God, Inosuke is just the flappiest piggy. All your favorites. And also Zenitsu. They board the train and they find out that they're not the only demon slayers here. See, I'm not the only one who thinks he has a dumb hairstyle. Ugh, this fucking guy.
Umai.
What a fucking psychopath. Who eats like this?
Umai.
Now I know in the past, I've said some, Does anybody like this guy's design? If Temari fused with a Flareon, this is what you'd get. If you dye your hair to match the color of your silly little cape, I'm gonna hate you unconditionally. Not to mention this dude's eyebrows look like they're desperately trying to escape his face. Controversial statements about Rengoku. And I'm sure many of you are having a... You look like Zenitsu evolved into a fire type. Many thoughts. But rest assured, whether I like it or not, you know, we'll get to it. Tanjiro takes this opportunity to ask Rengoku if he knows anything about his father or the fire style technique he used to use. Rengoku doesn't have any information for him, but offers to take Tanjiro under his wing and train him. The conductor arrives and punches everyone's tickets, but Tanjiro and Rengoku sense that there's a demon near. Nope, nothing suspicious about this guy. Super not a demon over here. Yeah, it's probably this guy. This dude looks like he was drowned 30 years ago. Are we really not gonna investigate this obvious ghoul of a man? Hey, if you're gonna say please ignore the fact that I brought a sword onto this public train, maybe don't do it with your eyes bugging out of your skull and a huge grin on your face. I feel like that's not the type of person they want bringing a sword onto a I found the demon! After Rengoku absolutely annihilates the demons. Ooh, alright, he did one cool thing. The whole crew wants to get mentored by him. Oh my god, you look like Anya Taylor-Joy became a McDonald's mascot. Could your eyes get any farther apart? We'll get to it! But everyone seems to get a little tuckered out after the fight. A little too tuckered out. Oh, no way, the guy who looks like the son of Chucky turned out to be evil? Who would've guessed? Oh, you dropped your- What?! Jesus Christ, what the hell are you?! Why is that so much worse than having the mouth on the palm of the hand? Turns out, Hansi McGee was controlling the conductor and a bunch of children, promising them that they'll get to live in their own sweet dreams for the rest of their lives if they do his bidding. Meanwhile, everyone on the train is fast asleep, and we get a glimpse into our heroes' dreamscapes. And look, I'm not gonna lie, this is the moment I realized this movie was fucking incredible. Oh no! No! Incredibly depressing, that is. Oh, stop it. Oh, stop! Why would they do this? This is so sad! This isn't a good time! This isn't a fun romp with all my favorite characters. That was horribly depressing. I mean, like, fuck me. Now, like I said before, I love the first season of Demon Slayer, but I always found its plot to lean dangerously close towards the side of generic. Tanjiro's a teenage boy training to be the best fighter so that he can hunt down the man who killed his family. You know, pretty standard shonen stuff. Now, that's not to say there aren't themes or narrative qualities that set Demon Slayer apart from other anime, and we'll get into those later, but I always sort of felt like the show wasn't reaching the emotional potential it could have been. I mean, when watching the anime, I was constantly forgetting that Tanjiro even had a dead family. Kid's whole goddamn family gets torn to shreds by demons, and all he ever talks about is his still pretty much living sister. Well, I may have forgotten about Tanjiro's dead family, the movie certainly did not. Actually, this scene gives me the sense that the audience was maybe supposed to forget about Tanjiro's family. The show gets you so engrossed in Tanjiro's journey and his mission to save Nezuko, that when this moment hits, you're like, oh yeah, that's how this all started. Hell, maybe Tanjiro forgot about his dead family too. I mean, he didn't really forget, but maybe his quest to save Nezuko has been enough of a distraction for him to momentarily push aside his grieving. Maybe he's tricked himself into thinking that saving Nezuko, the last piece of a family lost, will, in a way, save his family. Make him feel like he didn't totally fail them. Almost like when you've had a really bad day, so you just keep running around getting tasks done so you don't have to think about it. And then at the end of the day, when you finally sit down in your bed and the weight of all the shitty things that happened that day finally sinks in, it just makes you want to cry. What, nobody else? Just me? Well, that's what this scene feels like. Feels like Tanjiro finally sits down and has to deal with the weight of his past. Furthermore, the reason this scene hits so hard is because it doesn't just remind the audience that Tanjiro has a tragic backstory, it elaborates on why it's so tragic. I feel like a lesser movie would have Tanjiro stumble across a broken picture frame of his dead family or something. He'd cry for a bit and the audience would be like, oh, that's sad. And then we'd move on. Because it's just a reminder that this character's life is vaguely sad. But it doesn't add any new information. Here, we get the initial shock of the reminder, but we also get to see the life Tanjiro wishes he had. Most anime protagonists set out to be the best at something, whether it be the best ninja, pirate, fighter, whatever. Because it's something they've always wanted to be. But Tanjiro would so much rather not be a demon slayer. He even says at one point in this movie that he would rather be chopping wood with his family. But unfortunate circumstances forced him into this life. Like I said, when you're watching the show, it's easy to get swept up in the excitement of Tanjiro climbing the Demon Slayer ranks. Hell yeah! Tanjiro mastered a new technique! He's gonna be an awesome Hashira one day! But this scene reminds us that in actuality, he fucking hates this. He hates violence, he hates killing. And though he's made some close friends and awesome skills along his journey, you know he'd trade all of that away if it meant he could live a boring life with his family again. And it's made even more bittersweet by the fact that we're only 20 minutes into this goddamn movie, and I haven't even gotten to the part that people would deem the sad bit! We soon meet our villain, and it's revealed to be the demon Muzan empowered at the end of season 1. And I mean, this dude's just fantastic. His voice is like the perfect style of creepy. It's like he's in a constant limbo between crying and coming. You better get your toothy ass hands away from my toothy ass face! I'm not trying to get a hand job and a blow job all in one sitting from this movie theater valet. Anyway, while Tanjiro is being prepped for his upcoming existential nightmare. Oh, he thinks the real world was the dream world. But he's in the dream world now. Oh, you stop with this nonsense. He's a little soot boy again. Fuck! Can we just get credits? Can the movie- I'm cool with ending it here. Let's just call it a night movie, huh? What do you say? Let Tanjiro have his dream world and also die. That's fine. That's a fine compromise. Zenitsu's busy having a horribly creepy dream about Tanjiro's sister. And Inosuke's busy having a horribly creepy dream about Tanjiro's sister. Nezuko-san! Would you stop, you fucking weirdo? Why is this your dream? Of course Zenitsu would have the weirdest dream. You're all freaks! Can you all quit being weird around your best friend's sister? What even is this? Is this a sex dream to Inosuke? What is happening? What is going on in your head? Never have I wanted to be in Inosuke's head. He's literally feeding her his nuts. Somebody rescue me from this goddamn movie. We get to see Rengoku's dreamscape, and we discover that there may be some darkness behind that smile he always wears. It turns out Rengoku's father used to be a Hashira, but suddenly quit, and now forbids any of his children from climbing to the same rank. The whole family looks like that?! I don't know what would be worse, him dyeing his hair to match his cape, or him buying a cape that matches his hair. Oh, jeez. What am I saying? This movie's not gonna get me to care about Rengoku. Get out of here with this family's fucking hair! You guys look like someone lit a family of barn owls on fire. Ah! Oh my god, my heart! Oof! What a good big brother. What a sad fucking dream. Okay, I'm not saying I like him, but if I were to start, this is like such a good way to get me to do it. Because in the beginning, you've got like all the characters being like, man, Rengoku sure is cool. He's the best of all of them. And like, that's cool. And we saw him be like a badass, like fighting wise. But I feel like a worse movie would just kind of leave it at that and just have everybody continue to tell us that he's awesome without ever actually making us think he's awesome. And him, like this right here, this is getting me to think that he's pretty awesome. Like, that was such a great way to handle having a horrible piece of shit father when you're a big brother. I just feel like a lot of anime are very tell, don't show, and that was very much show. What the hell is going on right now? The villain's children enter our hero's dreams and try to, I don't know, kill their dream core or something. You know, it's like a bunch of fucking dream nonsense. Who cares? Tanjiro's blissfully unaware about his dream state, but his subconscious lets him know he's under attack.
Okio!
Thankfully, Nezuko wakes up, ravenous for headpats. Vengeful, even. Tanjiro starts to wake up, but then he hears a familiar voice that he hasn't heard in quite some time. Oh, stop! Oh no, stop it! Oh, with the salad! She brought you a salad! Oh my god, she hasn't spoken in forever! For real, honestly, no joke, I'm done with the jokes. Fuck this movie. It's a bad movie, it's poorly written, they can go fuck themselves for making this. And if that wasn't fucked enough, Tanjiro then realizes that the only way to wake up out of his dream is to fucking kill himself. Oh my god, this poor kid. Wow. Wow, so hardcore. So, such a hardcore day for a 14-year-old to experience. Wow, thank god that worked.
Nezuko, 大丈夫か?
You did it, Nezuko. You're the hero. Tanjiro finally wakes up, knocks out all the little helpers, and hunts down the demon at the head of the train. Wow, what a sick fuck. Why would you say that like a peppy schoolgirl, too? What a sick bastard. I can't wait for this movie to redeem him 3 seconds before he dies. I guarantee that's what's gonna happen. That is classic Demon Slayer right there. Tanjiro rushes down the demon, and holy shit is this fight sick. This scene is an excellent example of what makes Demon Slayer fights so engaging. The demon keeps putting Tanjiro to sleep, but Tanjiro immediately kills himself to wake himself up. And I don't know about you, but that's pretty fucking metal, if you ask me! What's great about the fights in Demon Slayer is that they're rarely about the raw strength or power level of the characters, and more about their skill and intelligence. The demons usually have very unique and cerebral powers, and they feel more like a puzzle Tanjiro has to solve rather than a combatant he has to fight. And this one's no different. Yo, is it just me, or does he sound exactly like Deku's English voice actor? God, that is hardcore! Oh my god! God, this is fucking dark! This demon's gonna make Tanjiro kill himself in real life! Tanjiro finally cuts the head off the demon and— oh god, oh jeez, what the fuck?! It turns out that the head Tanjiro cut off wasn't the demon's actual head, because the demon has actually become part of the train itself. We gotta talk about Demon Slayer's use of CGI. More importantly, we gotta talk about the fact that nobody talks about it. Because if you ask me, Demon Slayer is the only anime that I've seen that nails CGI. Vinland Saga's close. At first I was nervous seeing this giant, gross CGI meat tentacle. A lot of these shonen movies have a weird tendency of ruining their climaxes with terrible and out-of-place CGI. But just like the Demon Slayer show, the movie's use of CGI, in my opinion, is straight up flawless. I mean, yeah, it's pretty obviously CG. It's not gonna trick anyone into thinking it's 2D animation, but I think that's why it works. Yeah, it's computer generated, but it doesn't feel out of place. The coloring and movement of it totally match the colors and movement of the 2D world. It's a totally natural blend. To compare, look at Dragon Ball Super Broly. The whole movie, you're looking at these gorgeous 2D character designs. Iconic character designs that we've all known and loved for decades. Then all of a sudden, mid-fight, at the climax of the fight, the character models are swapped out with these distracting CGI ones. As if the audience wouldn't notice they were suddenly watching an advertisement for FighterZ. It's not that the animation is bad necessarily, it's just distracting because it's trying to trick us into thinking it's not CG. Not to mention, it's done during the scene you most want to see hand-drawn. Demon Slayer gets it right because it's not trying to trick us, and the CG elements are stylized in a way that fit into the 2D world. It's not trying to force the CGI to be something it's not. The CG elements are introduced as CG. It's not like Tanjiro or any character models start off as 2D and suddenly switch out for 3D ones. Anyway, Nezuko wakes up the Sleepy Boy gang, and thus begins the conclusion to one of the best personal arcs in all of anime. I am of course referring to Inosuke's arc of becoming the absolute best boy. Oh shit, it's your boy, Inosuke, baby! Woo! Yeah, not safe for the demon. I'll explain later. The demon starts consuming the train, and Rengoku tells Tanjiro to take Inosuke and find the demon's actual head. Meanwhile, Hizunitsu and Nezuko will stay behind and protect the passengers. You know, in a really weird and gross way, this is gorgeous. Why are you so fucking weird? I feel like the only thing keeping Zenitsu from straight up being a Hashira is just his shitty personality. Yes, good, fall back asleep. You've served your purpose. Nezuko looks like Ike from South Park. Oh, fuck yes. Hell yeah. Oh, you know this train has made its final stop. Hell yeah, Rengoku! God, what a good fucking boy. Don, they're best friends! Look at how far you've come, Inosuke. I'm so proud of you. He's come so far from being a- Holy Christ! I don't really have a joke for this, but what's that Yu-Gi-Oh card? You guys know what I'm talking about. Tanjiro gets put back into a dream loop in what is one of the most stressful scenes in all of cinema. That's right, Tanjiro, just keep killing yourself. No, don't kill yourself! If you die in the dream, you wake up, but if you die in the real, you die for real! Look, I'll be honest, it's hard to get me to actually care about the protagonist of a movie. Like, I'm way too cynical to let a movie trick me into thinking that its main character is gonna die like halfway through it. Oh no, is Spider-Man about to die like 45 minutes into a movie titled Spider-Man? Well, sometimes. And I get that there like has to be stakes and everything, but like, fucking, who are you trying to fool? Whose name's on the title, alright? The movie's not called Demon. My point is, it takes a lot to stress me out during an action movie. But I'd be absolutely lying if I said I wasn't curled up in a ball during the scene, dreading a world in which Zenitsu becomes the new main character of Demon Slayer. It is so stressful, because like I said before, the fights in Demon Slayer are more a test of intelligence than a test of strength. And so if Tanjiro's ever going to get beaten, it's gonna be because a demon outsmarts him. And so when he almost gets tricked into killing himself, yeah, that shit puts you on the edge of your seat. Your seat's in the next goddamn theater. But Inosuke, being the best boy that he is, stops Tanjiro before he wakes himself up out of reality. Tanjiro gets stabbed by the conductor. You bitch! But the two manage to slay the demon. God, these characters have the best fucking attitudes. Somebody get this guy a goddamn good piggy award for being such a good goddamn piggy. Yup, here it is. Last minute redemption time. You're not gonna get me to feel sorry for this handsy weirdo. Alright. Goddamn, chill out. Sorry, I should have said, please don't make me feel sorry for this handsy weirdo. Okay, I know I joke about this, but I really do love how Demon Slayer goes the extra mile in humanizing its villains. Even here, where the demon is never really redeemed, it's still incredibly sad and disturbing to watch him come to terms with his impending death. And that's because this show takes death incredibly seriously, which is a refreshing change from most shonen anime. Yeah, it's a little cheap and gimmicky because it always happens like seconds before they're killed, but I care less about what it means for the demons and more about what it means for Tanjiro. Tanjiro never wanted to become a demon slayer, but unfortunate circumstances led him down this path. The respect Tanjiro gives his enemies give his character a ton of depth. I mean, Tanjiro's family, despite me constantly forgetting, was slaughtered by demons, and his sister was turned into one too. This gives him a ton of cause to just outright hate demons. And while the fact that his sister has become a bloodthirsty demon should be a constant reminder as to why he hates them, it's actually why he respects them. I mean, Nezuko is just as bloodthirsty and dangerous as any other demon, but he knows she can't help herself. She reminds him that every demon was once a person that had their own humanity stripped away from them. And so he treats them all with the reverence he shows her. And this just makes for a way more unique and compelling character than if he just ran around hating demons the whole time. And for those of you who are gonna take to the comments and draw an obvious comparison to what I just said and, you know, Eren Yeager, I'll just say that I think Eren Yeager is a great character. I'm not saying that rage-fueled, vengeful protagonists can't be deep or compelling characters. I'm just saying that Tanjiro's attitude towards his enemies is one we rarely see in shonen anime, at least from what I've seen, and it's a welcome change. I haven't seen all of them, to be frank, you know, I could be totally wrong on that. But it's what makes me like Tanjiro. Rengoku helps Tanjiro focus his breathing to close his wounds. God, what a good big brother. I hate that Rengoku's like one of the best characters I've seen in a while. And a new, much stronger demon appears.
Now I'll stay.
God, what a sad ending. Oh, but that ain't the ending! Demon recognizes Rengoku's strength and offers to turn him into a demon. Rengoku refuses and the two fight.
Nobody enter!
Yeah, that's right, bitch. Get absolutely... fuck. Why does this guy have shag carpeting eyebrows? Also, did a car run over both sides of his face? Fuck, why didn't I think of that one? Jesus, this guy looks more like a spider than the spider demon. Also, there is something so sick about blocking sword slashes with your forearms. Oh my god, with the flame tiger. Oh, stop. Stop it. How dare you? How dare you make me care about Rengoku right now? If he dies, my trust will be betrayed on a level that I have not and will never experience again. Yes. Yes! Murder him! Wrong him! How'd you miss? It sounded like a pretty sweet deal right now, Rengoku. Take it! Oh, stop with the flashback. Flashbacks are never a good sign for characters that want to live, Rengoku. The hell is his mom, Muzan? Just become a demon. He looks like a macaroni penguin. What? Yes! Yes! Chop some wood! Cut his fucking head off. He is keeping this man's hand in his chest by sheer force of rage! What a fucking badass! Oh my god, please help him. Just start hacking away! Start sawing, start hacking! Cut his head off! Yes! You fucking coward. Holy shit. Well, damn it! I know, Tanjiro, I told him! I like how he's just like, dog, I gotta balance, the sun's coming up. What do you want from me? What do you want me to do?
I guess we should talk about Rengoku now.
He's great, alright? He's fucking great! Are you happy? I wanted to hate this character so fucking much. But you know what? He's just like such a good character. He's too good, but it's like kind of fucked. Because he's just Mirio. He's just Mirio. And that's like cheating. How are you gonna not love a Mirio? I certainly couldn't. I love a character that has a tortured past or lives under terrible circumstances and still manages to have a great attitude. Most of the time when we see a character with a troubled past, they're either acting like a brooding outcast or a angsty drama queen. And it's so much more compelling to see a character like Rengoku. When you experience a tragedy, the first thing your mind wants to do is either lash out or shut down. It's easy to let tragedy turn you into an angry or closed off person, but it's difficult to face those tragedies with optimism, because a lot of times, optimism just leads to disappointment. And what's even more impressive is that Rengoku isn't even feigning confidence to make himself feel better. It's to help others get through their own struggles. It's so inspiring to see Rengoku struggle against these odds. Whether it be his father's disappointment or the high-level demon standing in front of him, and put on a confident face because he knows it's what other people need to see. And yeah, when I was younger, I gravitated more to the edgy rival characters, your Sasukes, your Bakugos, you know, because I thought they were cool. But now it's like, you know, fucking grow up, dude. Go back to working at Spencer's Gifts and explaining to tweens why they're not old enough to buy your lollipops. On top of that, the fight scene's just incredible. Not just because of how great the choreography and animation are, but because of what this fight means for Tanjiro and the Demon Slayer anime going forward. This fight sets up such an exciting future for Demon Slayer. When Tanjiro killed the Dream Demon, he thought, man, that was a lot easier than I thought it'd be. And yeah, it turned out that the demon wasn't dead and got a lot stronger, but I still don't think he was that much more difficult than the Spider Demon at the end of Season 1. You get this sense that Tanjiro thinks he's nearing the end of his journey. Maybe he's got this whole Demon Slayer thing figured out. Maybe each new demon is only gonna be incrementally harder than the previous one. And that's why it's so great that this fight puts Tanjiro in his fucking place! Rengoku was the peak of power in Tanjiro's mind, and he needed to see him get thrashed to realize just how much of a little punk bitch he still is. Even Inosuke, the quickest piggy, doesn't even dare help because he can't keep up with their movements and speed. If Rengoku represents a Hashira's full potential, Akaza represents probably 50% of a demon's. Or something like that, I don't know. I'm sure the manga readers will correct me for that one. It's almost terrifying in a sort of existential way, and makes Muzan seem all the more intimidating. Tanjiro is seeing his hero, the peak of power in his eyes, get absolutely thrashed by a demon that's nowhere near as strong as the one he'll ultimately need to face. And this should make Tanjiro feel hopeless, right? Well, no, because even though Akaza is absolutely kicking Rengoku's ass, he's also constantly offering to turn Rengoku into a demon. And Tanjiro sees Rengoku refuse over and over again. Despite at one point being seconds away from death, Rengoku refuses to waver in his convictions, which only inspires Tanjiro more. And again, this sets up so many exciting things for the next season of Demon Slayer. Whether it's through exposing the terrifying capabilities of a high-ranking demon, or revealing the awe-inspiring capabilities of a high-ranking Demon Slayer, the movie uses Rengoku's character as a platform to tease the long-term future of the show. Meanwhile, Akaza's character is used to tease the show's short-term future. This is because the show sets up Akaza as a much more interesting villain than Muzan for the audience. Muzan took Tanjiro's family away from him, but Akaza is taking Rengoku away from us. We have personal beef with this guy, and we want to see Tanjiro hunt him down. Because, yeah, this fight, it doesn't end well. So unfortunately, the demon escapes, and Rengoku is left having seen better days. Rengoku gives Tanjiro some parting words of wisdom, and my god, is it fucking sad. God, this is so brutal. It's such good writing. Because he's like, it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter who won, because he got away, you know? That's what makes it so sad. And Inosuke's twitching up a storm. What a cruel and devastating film! How dare this fucking movie! Oh, and he so needed to hear it too. You know? Ugh. I am literally one heartache away from burning my house down. Oh no! Where are the matches? God, this movie's fucking gorgeous. How is it so pretty? This is so fucked. This is unbelievably fucked. Stop! Oh my god. This was so... He's been dying for like 15 minutes.
Kriyashina.
Oh, that broke my heart. Heart shattered. We gotta... Emergency heart glue. What? That was such a vulnerable thing to say. They nail characters like just saying what they feel without it feeling like cheesy. Like that was the most vulnerable, real thing I've ever heard. Something about just being like, I'm so frustrated is so much more powerful than like, you bastard. Oh, Inosuke. Oh, I never wanted to hear Inosuke cry. Never. He's just the flappiest boy. This was so well done. I can't fucking believe I felt anything for this dumb character. Are you fucking kidding me? Who would have thought that a shonen anime movie could get me to care about a character I went into wanting to hate in 2 hours and then almost cry when he dies? Imagine if, like, Tapion had that effect. I thought Rengoku was gonna be a Tapion. I mean, I guess I should have seen this coming. All the demons' deaths are fucking cripplingly sad. I should have known a side characters would ruin me. And part of what makes this death so sad is just how seriously the movie takes it. Rengoku doesn't just give some parting words, close his eyes, and that's the end of it. The film lingers on this death for a while, showing how each character is affected by it. It isn't just sad because you're gonna miss this character in future episodes. It's sad because you see how the loss of his life affects the other characters. All I know is that if Inosuke ever dies in this show, I'm gonna burn my goddamn house down. Okay, I know it's a weird time to bring this up, but let's talk about why Inosuke has like one of the best goddamn arcs in all of anime. When we first meet Inosuke, he's your classic, hot-headed, battle-hungry edgelord whose whole existence is centered around growing stronger. It's nothing we haven't seen before. He's mean and aggressive towards everyone and is usually met with equal amounts of aggression. However, when Tanjiro starts responding to his aggression with compliments and positive reinforcement, Inosuke's whole system just fucking short-circuits. You get the sense that Inosuke's been treated negatively his entire life and has just come to expect it at this point. It isn't until he meets someone like Tanjiro who treats him with respect that he realizes how good positive reinforcement feels. In essence, all Inosuke ever wanted was to be told that he's a good boy. How fucking sweet is that? And now that he and Tanjiro have been friends for a while, Inosuke's paying back all of Tanjiro's compliments. And it's just adorable. I just love it because it's almost like a subversion on the usual hot-headed anime rival trope. Usually the angsty rival develops a respect for the protagonist because he ends up recognizing him as like a worthy competitor. That's the case here. Inosuke definitely respects Tanjiro as a fighter, but you get the sense that he kind of respects him more as just being like a good person. He's just like... like, I don't know, Inosuke's just fucking adorable. He just wants, like, verbal head pats. He just likes hearing that he's doing a good job. No one's ever told him he's doing a good job. Inosuke wants to become a good person like Tanjiro because Tanjiro taught him how good it feels to be treated well. But yeah, the movie kind of just ends after Rengoku's death. And that's Mugen Train. And kind of, you know, weird for me to have ended on a huge rant about Inosuke's character arc, but... I guess no weirder than me taking 3 months to put this video out. Sorry again, it took so long. It kept going through like different variations. I kept changing the format of it. I finally landed on this. I think this is like a happy medium between what people come to my channel for. It would be cool to start like giving legitimate thoughts on anime like this when I feel like, you know, I have a point that others aren't really necessarily picking up on, perhaps. So that's kind of my attempt at that here. What did you guys think of this, like, half analysis, half reaction, sort of review breakdown thing? And I think this is a lot more sustainable to do than, like, the daily reactions I was trying to do with Given. I will finish Given. I've just become unbelievably busy, and I think making videos like this, I can do weekly. I for sure could do weekly. It wouldn't take, like, another 2 or 3 months per video. I'm thinking about finishing Given's reaction series and then doing this kind of reaction analysis breakdown type video on the Given movie. I then think I'm gonna do one on DreamWorks' Spirit the Horse. Trust me, it deserves one. And then yeah, like I said, if you like this, comment what other movies or shows I should do like this also. Maybe I'll do series like this. Instead of reacting to each individual episode, I just kind of do it wholesale. And as usual, you know, subscribe, share, please. That'd be fantastic. And yeah, I'll see you guys next time. Hi, Danny from the future here, just chiming in to say, it gets worse! I know I just promised I would make more of these analysis videos, but as I'm editing this, over the past 30 years, you know, it gives a man a lot of time to reflect. As you can tell, I've aged about 30 years, I'm scruffy now, I've got woodsman attire to show my knowledge and wisdom. And as I'm editing this, it occurs to me that it might be funnier to cut out the analysis. But I worked so hard on the analysis, so I kept it in anyway. But I'm like piecing it together, and I'm looking at all the reaction stuff, and I'm like, man, you know, this is funny stuff. I'm giving these people some premium 1800s, real, like, old prospector grade gold. And meanwhile, I look like a pretentious douchebag given all this analysis. So yeah, sorry for the billion-year-long outro. I'm still editing this goddamn thing. And I'm clearly insecure about coming off as a pretentious asshole in the analysis, so it's really gonna be up to you. Really stroke my ego, because apparently I need it. And, you know, hopefully one day I'll finish editing this. This is my inside. Did you guys see inside?
That was cool when Bo took a year or so to work on a video, and then everyone loved it, and everyone loved him for doing it. I'm the Bo Burnham of anime. That's me. This will never come out. I've never related to somebody more than him, and this is so... This is only hyped because I've hyped it. I'm in a prison of my own devising. And only you can let me out by letting me know if you want more of these videos. I'll make them. They won't take this long, I promise. I figured it out. I swear I'm almost done with this fucking outro. I just gotta get out of this box. Yeah, if you want more analysis videos, like it's no problem at all. Just let me know. Yeah, anyway, done. No more outro. I'm gonna get back to editing this now.